Good afternoon. The past year, in the wake of a violent and exceptionally public rape, has seen an extraordinary mobilization of people as women, as workers, as citizens, as persons who move and must move through the city and town, on the road and highway, with dignity and in the full measure of their humanity. Among the most cogent, supremely intelligent, and powerful voices within this mobilization, as well as a careful commenter upon it, has been that of our honored guest in the 2013 Maharaj Kala lecturer, Kavitav Krishna. My name is Lawrence Cohn. I'm privileged as the director of the Center for the Study, the Center for South Asian Studies. This is my life, I didn't know it's so. To welcome you all, and in a moment to introduce my esteemed colleague, Raka Ray, who will have the honor of introducing Kavitav Krishna and of leading a conversation with her after her lecture today. So the Center for South Asian Studies, for those who don't know it, is on campus in Stevens Hall. It has an extraordinary repertoire of events, lectures, seminars, groups meeting. If you are not yet involved, I encourage you to get on our website, come to a series of upcoming events. There are many. And to be involved in helping shape those events in the future. I want first to address the fund that has made possible Kavitav Krishna's coming here today, as well as to thank our co-sponsors for this event. So this is the annual Maharaj Kala lecture. I'll speak in a moment about the Maharaj Kala Memorial Fund and its establishment and about Maharaj Kala. Our co-sponsors are also ASHA for Education at Berkeley, the Global and Executive Programs at the Golden School of Public Policy, the Department of Gender and Women's Studies, the Beatrice Bain Research Group, the Association for India's Development, the International Action Network for Gender Equity and Law, the Department of Sociology, and Maitri for coming together and making this event possible. The Maharaj Kala Memorial Fund produces what is one of the most extraordinary lecture series we have at present at Berkeley. Maharaj Kala, who sadly passed away in 2009, was a tireless campaigner against injustice and for peace, the founder of many groups such as the India Relief and Education Fund and the Coalition Against Communalism. Under the directorship of the Center, my predecessor, Raka Ray, the family of Maharaj Kala established the Maharaj Kala Memorial Fund at University of California, Berkeley. The fund supports both this lectureship in the spirit of the work of Maharaj Kala and a graduate travel and research fellowship. I wanted briefly to acknowledge current and past awardees. Last year there were two awardees who I believe are present today. I haven't met them, so I'm wondering, could Katya Trukumili stand up if Katya's here? And hi, thank you. And Katya is in environmental engineering. Her project is scaling up low-cost arsenic remediation for South Asia within a sustainable and scalable business model. And thank you very much. This is our awardee this year. And then from 2012, Manisha Anantharaman. Is Manisha here? This project in environmental science policy and management is recycling community or reinforcing hegemony, green consumption, and citizenship among the new middle classes of India. I wanted again to thank both the family of Maharaj Kala and Raka Ray and the center and all of you for establishing and sustaining this fellowship by participating in these lectures every year. Finally, it's my pleasure to introduce Raka Ray. Raka Ray is the chair of the Department of Sociology, the former director of the center, a longtime friend of Maharaj Kala, who's worked with the family to establish this, and an extraordinary Kala scholar, both of gender, of political economy and of political mobilization in India, Raka Ray.
Thank you, Lawrence, for your your eloquence, as always. The terrible gang rape that occurred in Delhi on December 16th, 2012, energized a nation to protest, to express outrage, and above all to demand that something be done to make the streets of India safer for its women. While much has been made since then of the gruesomeness of the rape, and media coverage sort of continues to sensationalize the issues around that gruesome rape, as well as to selectively sensationalize other rapes that have since happened, I believe that the lesson we should all take to heart is that something else happened on that terrible day. A movement was reborn. Young women, mothers, students, parents, young men, fathers, all said that this was enough. Playwright and women's rights activist Eve Ensler happened to be traveling in India shortly after, in late December, when the protests were all taking place. And she said she'd never seen anything like it. And I quote Eve Ensler. She said, "To see men and women coming to the streets to demonstrate against rape is a breakthrough in terms of human consciousness. I cannot think of a country in my lifetime where this has ever happened, including in the US. We are in the middle of something extraordinary." We were indeed in the middle of something extraordinary, and one of the moving spirits behind this movement, or rather one of the clearest and boldest articulators of this spirit, is Kavita Krishnan, whose speech during the protest outside Chief Minister Sheila Dixit's house on December 19th was one of the most brilliantly articulated defenses of women's right to freedom and adventure that I have ever heard. And I'm not just the only one who was wowed by it. In its Hindi original, it has almost 55,000 hits on YouTube. And many, many in translation. This, after all, is the crux of the matter. Who defines safety for women, and what rights must women give up to be able to be safe? All of Kavita Krishnan's writing around this issue has highlighted both political and economic on the one hand, and ideological factors on the other that enable sexual assault to happen and go unpunished, not just for the citizens of urban India, but also for poor and rural women. But Kavita Krishnan did not leap into activism on December 16, 2012. She has a lifetime of dedication to issues of equality and justice. Raised in Chhattisgarh with a college degree from St. Xavier's College, Mumbai, and MA and MPhil degrees from JNU, Kavita Krishnan has been an activist all her life. She was the joint secretary of the JNU Students' Union in 1995, where she led a movement against the murder of student activist Chandrasekhar in 1997. She was active in organizing student protests against the privatization of education, against violence by the state, against sexual harassment in the workplace. She is the national secretary of the All India Progressive Women's Association, an organization that is active in women's struggles against discrimination and violence and for women workers' rights, and also for the rights of Dalit women laborers. As a result of the generosity of the family of Maharaj Paul, we are able to continue his fierce legacy of keeping progressive ideas and movements from South Asia alive here at Berkeley. Given this past year, given the events of this past year, I can think of no one more fitting to be the third Maharaj Paul Memorial Lecturer today. So please join me in welcoming Kavita Krishnan.
I'd like to start by thanking the Center for South Asian Studies, Berkeley, and the family of Maharaj Paul. It's a real honor to be here and to be delivering the Maharaj Paul Memorial Lecture, because Maharaj Paul was a remarkable public intellectual and activist, and I think that a very remarkable legacy that he leaves behind, and it's good that it's being carried forward in a way so that the dialogue between South Asian activism and the institution of which he was an alumnus can continue in all the ways which he brought it alive in his lifetime. So it's a really big honor to be here, and thank you so much for having me. And you know, when I was thinking about how to frame this talk, because you know, we've been talking around these issues so much in India, but so I thought that it would be good. See, the movement has been, you know, a lot of people have seen the movement post December 16th, but seen it probably through certain kinds of images which have appeared on the internet or in the media, and perhaps some of the commentaries around it. So I just thought that as a reference point to what I'll be talking about, it would be good to have the movement as a reference point, but also to go beyond that and you know, think about some of the issues around it in a broader way. So I don't want to exceed my time, so I just want to, you know, keep my watch in front of me, which I committed to do before this. I'll just keep that in mind. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, as you know, it was an exceptionally graphic and brutal rape. All right, and it was a very remarkable and exceptional movement that happened after that. But I think that the whole thing was that within the movement, and within probably for any women's movement anywhere, for any movement around the rights of women and around any issues of gender, there's always, it's never as easy as flowing with a spontaneous upsurge. It's always probably continuous, even in movements which we ourselves craft, which this was not one of them, this was a spontaneous upsurge. But even in movements which we ourselves craft, the questions which we have to keep asking ourselves and reminding ourselves are about how we frame the terms of the debate. Because there's nothing that we can take for granted, and we have to continually question ourselves, you know, in the process of a movement. And probably this is true of most movements, but certainly very, very true in a very specific way about movements involving women. Because I can imagine that in a movement about labor rights or possibly against corporate land grab, you could imagine that the participants in the movement would hold dear certain slogans without feeling any kind of ambiguity towards those slogans. Whereas I think that in any women's movement, even those which are shaped by, crafted by women's organizations who have given their lifetime to such work, there's always an ambiguity involved, because you are hitting at the roots of the very things of which you are constituted. So it's a process in which it is liberating, but it is at the same time it is scary, it's dangerous to all the things which give you stability. So it's something that can continuously disturb stability. So I think that how that happened in this movement is worth understanding. For me as well, it's a good opportunity here to be able to reflect a little bit about how things happen, so that we can actually take away something from there and not look at it as just something that happened in India because things are particularly bad in India, but as something for which we can learn for movements of a similar kind and hope for such movements everywhere. So as you know, the verdict in the December 16th case in the Sessions Court in Delhi came out recently, and a death penalty was awarded to four of the accused. And there's been a approving chorus from, you know, figures in government and other political figures, opposition leaders and so on. There's been some public protests saying, yes, we are vindicated, the family feels vindicated. And at least on part of the government, it's as though we are being told, all right, we've made some changes in the law and now this verdict is here. So you have to close off any questions. You know, we've moved forward, we've done a good job, it was a good investigation, you got a good conviction and a death sentence, so it's all done and dusted. But I think that, you know, when you think about, as you, I don't think I need to elaborate here very much. Later in the question answers, we can talk about the death penalty and why we never asked for it. The women's movement groups never asked for it. And even during the movement, a very large section of the movement very consciously did not ask for it and did not support it. But I think that we have to think about the ways in which a brutal, graphic rape in the national capital of this kind is actually something that does actually pose a challenge for a patriarchal state as well. Because in a way, they are challenged because they are, you know, they are told, you're not man enough to protect our women, that kind of thing. And, you know, even after the Mumbai gang rape that's happened recently, you had Raj Thackeray, the leader of right-wing group in Mumbai, offering bangles to the police chief and so on. Similar things were happening even in Delhi, where people were saying Julie Pahenlo, you know, Delhi Police Commissioner should wear bandanas, this kind of thing. So you're effeminized because you couldn't protect our women and so on. So I think that there's some ways in which the demand for an equally graphic retribution for rapists in such a case is actually very reassuring to patriarchy, because it can reassure itself of its ability to avenge and punish, and it can say, we are man enough to avenge our women. And we've taken notice of this case, we've avenged it, and that's it. So I think there are ways in which for the women's movement especially, the question has always been, how to change this topic, how to jolt the discourse out of patriarchy's zone of comfort, and actually bring it back to the zone of uneasiness which the women's movement always inhabits, and must always inhabit if it is to remain exciting and challenging and important and actually a threat to patriarchy. So actually, I think the whole question was that even before this movement, these thoughts were in our mind. I remember writing a piece a few months before that, reflecting over movements which my organization was conducting against rape and other similar groups as well. And thinking about how it's not enough to oppose rape, because when you raise a slogan against rape, there's hardly anyone who'll disagree. Everyone will say, yes, rape is a bad thing, especially if it has resulted in physical injury and death and so on and so forth. No one's going to say it's a bad thing, rape is a bad thing. But how to protest against sexual violence in a way that challenges rather than reassures patriarchy, and that that doesn't help to restore the patriarchal order but serves to destabilize it. I think this is a concern for the women's movement, and so some of the things that we were talking about, these conversations we were having within my organization and within the women's movement some months before this movement, those actually came to the fore in that speech that you talked about. So I don't think I was the only person making that speech, so I'm a little embarrassed by all those YouTube hits and all that, because there were so many other young people at that time, so many other even college students and so on, who were saying similar things, and that was what I think was remarkable about this movement. So I think what was happening there was that we were trying to unpack the whole question of protection for women, which is something which everyone's very comfortable with. When you raise the slogan and you say women want protection, it's something which no one will disagree with. Yes, yes, women should be secure, women should be protected. But the question, to look at the ways in which the fear of rape serves to discipline all women, or the ways in which the agenda of protection is framed in a way that is actually very restrictive of women's freedom to be free people, free persons, and the ways in which women are taught that good behavior can kind of win you a reprieve from rape. And I don't think that these questions are restricted to India alone. We know that the sort of rape culture, for want of a better word, I don't mean it to say that it's only a cultural thing, but I mean the culture of blaming women for rape and so on. I think it takes different avatars in different countries and different societies. An Indian context has its specifics. In India, it's possible for people to say that westernized women get raped and Indian women don't. But I think that in the United States, they won't be able to do that, but they can say, oh, you were drunk, so possibly, you couldn't say, you asked for it. And you have had, a Canadian cop saying things very similar to Delhi cops saying that you dressed like a slut, so you don't really have, you must have somehow invited this violence on yourself. So I think the ways in which that was being challenged was what was exciting for us from day one, because in the spontaneous mobilizations that were happening, we could see that, of course, there were lots of, I'll show you some photographs after this talk very briefly. So there were, of course, lots and lots of things with the picture of the noose and demanding hanging and all of that. But at the same time, there were also lots of young women with hand-painted posters saying, don't teach us how to dress, teach men not to rape, and saying, teri nazar buri to main parda kyun karun, things like that. Why should I have to hide if you're the one who's looking at me with violence in your eyes? So all of that was there, and I think that was what was very exciting for us in terms of how do we understand, how this movement was challenging rape culture. So what we wanted to do was that we wanted to sort of nurture, help those slogans come to the fore. I think that was all that we in the women's movement groups were doing there, and we were trying to bring those issues to the fore and help them to find a more powerful platform. And we found that there was a huge number of people who were actually interested in doing exactly that, including young men, because in we also were seeing young men who were looking at these slogans and then making hand-painted posters of their own, saying, if we wear a shirt that displays our body, displays our muscles, we don't get raped. So clearly they were thinking about how clothes are linked to rape in this easy way and trying to challenge that. And then we had young men coming up to us and raising the slogans that women were raising, saying, Mahilaye Maange Azadi, we want freedom, women want freedom. And then coming and talking about how uneasy they felt with that slogan and how, they were uneasy with the idea that their sisters would be as free as they, and saying, oh, wouldn't that make her more insecure? You know, what kind of freedom are we talking about? But the fact is that they were able to talk and think about those things in a way which probably a few months before that they would not have been doing. They would have been comfortable in their own skins before that, but now there was discomfort, and a discomfort they were willing to discuss and talk about. So I think that was really very important. And then the other very important thing in this movement was how the movement kind of moved beyond this one case of exceptionally graphic violence and moved on to confront how rape is justified in so many contexts. Of course, in the everyday context, where after every case of sexual violence, there'll be a discussion of what the woman could have done to avoid rape. That happens in every case in India and probably in most cases everywhere. All right. But then we also, the conversation was widened to discuss how the sense of entitlement that men feel over women's bodies, which is, from where rape flows, is also a specific kind of entitlement in some cases. For instance, why Dalit women are raped by upper caste men to remind them that they are Dalit women. Or how Nadivasi women, indigenous women, are raped because to punish them for protesting against corporate land grab. Or custodial rapes that happen by the army or by the police. Or marital rape, which is a kind of custodial rape within the marriage. And of course, violence faced by people of a different sexual orientation. All these came up for discussion in a way in which I, for one, would not have imagined it was possible on a Delhi street to do this. And the fact that it happened for several months, for at least 2.5 months, and again in a sustained way, where the discussion kept deepening and it was possible to continue to sustain the movement, was really a very remarkable experience. So I won't say that this was the only thing that was happening in that movement. There were several strands in it. There must have been several who would continue to want to hold on to that obsession with the death penalty and nothing else, not want to listen to anything else. But that I'm just trying to say that it was very varied, and there was a very considerable section that wanted to go beyond that question. And then you had the whole question of as we began to raise these questions, we found that the discomfort in the government and the political forces, even the opposition leaders, immediately began to grow. Because after this terrible case, initially there were no statements for a while. The usual statements trotted out about why was she out at night, why was she out with her boyfriend, didn't happen immediately. But soon after we began raising these questions, we realized that those areas of discomfort became so visible. So you started having some leaders of, one leader of the Congress Party in Andhra Pradesh saying, oh, we got freedom at midnight, that doesn't mean women are free to roam around at night. And then you had, of course, the RSS chief, Mohan Bhagwat, talking about how rapes happen in India, not in Bharat. And, it's all about, Bharat is basically the, it's basically to say that in traditional India, it wouldn't happen, but in westernized India, it will. So it's westernization that leads to rape, and Indian values, Indian culture will keep you safe from rape. So the good part was that immediately after this, there became a big, I attended meetings with young students and young people, college students organized soon after these discussions. And there would be angry outbursts with people standing up and saying, Mohan Bhagwat wears khaki shorts. How come he can wear shorts but we can't, that kind of thing. So, the RSS uniform, the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh uniform is khaki shorts modeled on the Hitler's, or Mussolini's brigades and so on. So they would raise this question that what's Western, what's Indian about khaki shorts, okay? So you can wear them but you tell them that you can't wear those. So there would be this spontaneous anger against that as well. And then we found that also the government was also very, very uneasy and uncomfortable. Of course, you had that famous remark by the president's son, Abhijit Mukherjee, saying dented and painted women. All the protesters are these dented and painted women, you know, who basically go to discos and nightclubs at night and they have nothing better to do, so they're protesting in the daytime. All this, of course, added fuel to the fire. But I think what was most significant was the deepest discomfort that the government had, the real fault lines, where with the question of both custodial rape and marital rape. So when the question came to the changes in the law, it was hard enough to get any of the other changes going, but with the force of the movement, you know, the definition in rape, of rape was expanded. Several other things happened which we wanted to happen in the law. But the two points, the two biggest sticking points were, one, with the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which confers some degree of impunity on army officers accused of violent crimes, including murder and including rape. So what the Justice Verma Committee set up during the movement had recommended was that, vis-a-vis the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, was that at least in cases where sexual violence is involved, army officers should be tried in an ordinary court of law and they should not enjoy the kind of impunity that they do now. But that was something on which the government was unwilling to budge. And the other question was marital rape, because the whole thing about marital rape became about, you know, the rape law has a specific exemption for marital rape. So it says that a wife cannot accuse a husband under any circumstance of rape. So we were asking that that exemption should go, but they were unwilling under any circumstance to do that. And it became very clear that in both these kinds of situations, they saw it as a custodial situation, and they were most uncomfortable with the idea of the sanctity of the army and the sanctity of the marital home being disturbed in any way. All right. So at the same time, the slogans on the street were raising slogans of Azadi in so many contexts. And one of the most exciting times in the movement, which I just want to, you know, briefly, I'll show you photographs of that later after this, was that 26 January, as you know, is India's Republic Day. So in some ways that has a very emancipatory legacy, because it's the day that the constitution was adopted, and, you know, Dr. Ambedkar drafted the constitution. There are some you know, aspects of it that are quite progressive and all of that. But actually, the Republic Day has become a day for a military parade, for the parade and display of military arsenal, and it's a sacred cow. You're not supposed to question the army, question in that nationalist spirit or sentiment in any way on that day. And I know that we were uncomfortable. You know, it wasn't as though this march on 26 January that happened in Delhi was our idea. We were actually very unsure whether we'd be able to do it, because we thought the police will never allow us to hold a march. How on earth are we going to do it? So we kept saying, let's do it on 24th, let's do it on 25th. But what happened was that from the ground, you know, at that time, the most of the protests were happening at Jantar Mantar. And over there, we kept getting this feedback from, you know, day-to-day participants in the movement saying, no, we want to do something on 26th January. Initially, they said, we want a boycott. But then we talked about it, and we thought that instead of a boycott, we should actually say, why should we boycott anything? We should say that, you know, we want to put the public back into the Republic. We want to remind people that there's a public there in the Republic, and that the Republic is not about the public being spectators to some military parade. It's actually about people's freedom, about women's freedom, of course, but also about other, you know, freedom in other contexts, the freedom of Dalit people, the freedom to protest, which people were very upset about. You know, one of the reasons why this whole business about the anger against the Republic Day parade came up was because the parade would march down the same road where protesters had been really, subjected to tear gas and beating and all of that. So they said, we can't march there, and, you know, these people will stand there and take salutes there, the government. So there's a lot of anger about that. So that day was actually a very remarkable day of protest, because I think for the very first time in Delhi, I've never seen that happen before. On 26 January, we would have been happy had there been 200, 300 people, but there were more than 2,000, and there were people, some of them joining after having watched the Republic Day parade, but they were marching alongside, you know, Kashmiri youth who were holding slogans saying, your republic rapes in Kashmir. All right, they were marching alongside persons holding the names. You know, we had names of people who had survived or been victims to rape in the Gujarat genocide, in Manipur, in so many different contexts. Even a gay professor in Aligarh Muslim University who had been forced to commit suicide because He had been subjected to public humiliation, all of that. So it was very exciting because at the end of that march, all those things were talked about, and it was, I'll show you some of the images, and I think that was a very, very remarkable moment, that if this movement could produce that protest, I think that that's really a very, very important landmark for Delhi and for India and for anywhere. Now, the other thing that was happening in the part of this movement was, as I said, the slogan became about women want freedom, Mahila Chahti Azadi. And we realized that when we were raising slogans against the Khap Panchayats, the caste, the caste or clan bodies that are implicated in the so-called honor killings, all right, which are basically custodial killings of couples who marry in defiance of caste norms. So we would say, Khap Se Azadi. And we would find people spontaneously raising slogans, girls especially saying, Baap Se Bhi Azadi, Bhai Se Bhi Azadi, that kind of thing. And these were the slogans which later caused the greatest uneasiness even among the protesters, even among all of us. I would say even among the left, progressive, all of that. They would say, Baaki sab kuch theek hai, lekin ye kaise lagaye, kahan lagaye, bahut dikkat ho rahi hai. People were not going to accept it, that kind of thing. But those were the most powerful slogans, and they were important because they were challenging the notion of the home as a safe haven and the streets as unsafe. So they were making visible the violence of everyday patriarchy, which would be very benign, which would be in the name of loving protection and all of that. And they were making that visible. So I was, some of the students who were protesting would use these lines from Alok Dhanwa's poem, Bhagi Hi Ladkiyan, Runaway Girls. There's a very excellent English translation that's around if someone's interested. I think Amitabh Kumar's done it. But I just read out the lines in Hindi. It says, Ghar ki janjeerein kitna zyada dikhai padti hain jab ghar se koi ladki bhaagti hai. How visible the shackles of the home become when a girl runs away from home. Because if she has to run away to get married, you realize that she's had to run away from something. This is clearly a custodial situation. Then, there were lots of posters with Gaurav Pandey's poems about how there are walls in every home. Ghar ghar mein diwari hai, ghar ghar mein shamshan ghat hai, ghar ghar mein fansi ghar hai. And he said, diwaron se takra kar girti hai wo. Girti hai aadhi dunya, sari manushyata girti hai. So they have these slogans about how the walls of the house, the windows of the house are locked. So, in the house where the woman is supposed to be the Ghar Ki Lakshmi, she's deified there, this is her safe place and all of that. So, these were conscious attempts to really challenge that notion of the patriarchal protection and make visible the custodial character of the household, where the the domestic labor, the reproductive labor and sexual labor of women is actually regulated, and where in the Indian context, it's regulated everywhere. But in the Indian context, it's the aspect of caste is also something very very crucial to this, where the control of women's sexuality is crucial to maintaining the purity of the caste. You can't do it without that. So, the ways in which caste and gender are useful in maintaining the labor hierarchies and maintaining, ossified relationships where you're able to extract exploitative labor. Those were things which became discussed in an everyday discourse on the streets, and that was very exciting. So there were these talks which people would do, even now when the Raksha Bandhan festival has recently passed. So I remember that even during the movement this had begun, and this happened during now as well, where we would talk about the questions of protection and honor, and how the Raksha Bandhan, we would be talking during these mobilization meetings and so on about how the Rakhi festival is supposed to be where the sister ties a Raksha Bandhan to her brother. But then, it's basically a Bandhan for the sister and, a Raksha that's promised on part of the brother, the protection that he will promise. And for her, it's the Bandhan, it's the bondage, it's those bonds. All right. So these things were discussed and in very exciting and exciting ways. And so you would have people challenging this idea of the brother wanting to protect. And I'll say that, that's the part, see, these were the most exciting and I would say the most important parts of the movement. But on parts of the governments, on part of the police, on part of the authorities, even on part of the corporations which were making use of this to make ads in the wake of this and all of this, they didn't seem to be wanting to listen to any of this, all right? So you had, after the Mumbai gang rape recently, you had a police commissioner in Mumbai saying that rapes are happening because people are kissing in public. You had a former police commissioner of Mumbai saying that 90% of rape cases are false because you see most of those women are not severely injured enough to be landing up in hospital severely injured. So clearly these are the factors which are inhibiting inhibiting convictions, why the conviction rate is so low in rape. And then you have judges, you had a judge recently, a Chennai High Court judge, say at a public function about the December 16th rape victim, why was she out at night? And then of course since then you had the Asaram Bapu rape case and all of that, and how there's a deep discomfort with questioning sexual violence by figures of trust and authority. And I think we'll talk about more of that when we have a discussion after this, about how it was, there was an attempt by governments, both the Mumbai government and the Delhi governments have tried to say that the rapes happening in these cities are because of immigrant labor. Some people have tried to say that, you should legalize prostitution and that will prevent rape because that is, it's a demand supply problem. So it's all these migrant workers coming without their families, they're not getting sex. So, you provide it to them and it will solve the problem of rape. Or it's these migrant workers who are coming from rural parts of the country and they can't really get used to urbanized women. That's why it's happening. So it was also a challenge to continuously challenge all of this and put these in perspective and say that no, it is not only in these two cases, the Delhi and the Mumbai candidates, these two particular cases, it was migrant workers who were raping, but in the Delhi case, the victim herself was also a migrant worker. So it wasn't as simple as that at all. As I said, as we raised all these questions, as I said, even among activists in left and progressive circles, there's been this widely prevalent notion that the question of women's azadi, women's freedom, and the minute you say azadi, of course you mean azadi in a whole variety of contexts, but it's usually taken to mean sexual freedom. And so that is something which is a bit embarrassing. It's okay to raise it in Delhi, but don't raise it among rural contexts or conservative working class localities. That's been something which even subsequent to the movement, even within our own organizations and movements, we've had these conversations, we've had these discussions. As I said, people saying, "Baap se azadi, we can't, khap se azadi chalega." We can do that, but we don't want the khap panchayats. But to question the authority of the father in the home, the question of the parents, the authority of parents in the home, this is something we don't want to be doing. It's uncomfortable to do that. People don't agree with you easily. But I think the most exciting part is that has happened. And the fact is, I think what we've had to confront is how important and how this is a central agenda, how you can't have any emancipatory agenda without this being very central to it. And one example of that I'll share with you, two examples very briefly. One is the recent communal violence in Muzaffarnagar, which some of you may have heard of. You're going to probably see more of these in the run-up to the 2014 elections. Now, in Muzaffarnagar, what was very significant to me was the fact that the platform for communal mobilization was the Jat Khaps, the Jat Khap Panchayats, the clan bodies, which I said are implicated in the so-called honor killings and so on. They were the platform, and they were raising the bogey. Then this is where the BJP leaders, the Bharatiya Janata Party leaders, came and addressed meetings, stoking the communal fires, and trying to imply, see, they raised the bogey of a so-called love jihad. So I already wanted to just flag the idea that Islamophobia in terms of targeting young Muslim youth as potential terrorists, arresting them, holding them in custody, illegally torturing them and so on, even when they later turn out to be innocent. This has become part of state policy. It flows from the US post 9/11, and I think it's become a global phenomenon, and in India it's very much part of state policy. It's not just the BJP that's doing it, it's the Congress governments and the Samajwadi Party governments, all of them are doing it. But now there's a specific aspect to it where they're saying there's also a love jihad. So basically the young Muslim youth are being projected as persons who are, look at them, they're wearing jeans, they're having these mobile phones, they're doing these things, they're targeting our daughters, they will make love to them, they will marry them, they'll convert them and so on and so forth. So there's this whole projection of love jihad that's happening, and the slogans in those khap panchayats were of course against love jihad, but they were also saying, beti bachao, babu bachao, save your daughters. I just talked to you about how we were trying to, question this idea of protection and mahilaon ko bachana in the movement. And here we were seeing these concerns over women's safety, the whole agenda of women's protection being used openly for communal mobilization, saying save your daughters-in-law. And then the Beti Bachao Bahu Bachao slogan turned into a Beti Bachao Bahu Banao slogan. So abduct their women, abduct Muslim women, rape them, whatever, make them our daughters-in-law. All right. So it became, this was the slogan, save your daughters, you know, make them your daughters-in-law, like that. And I think it clearly links up with, if you read Savarkar and other ideologues of Hindutva, this has been around for a long time. Savarkar criticized Shivaji and Chimaji Appa, saying that, oh, they were not, aggressive and virile enough to rape Muslim women in the wars they fought. And if Hindutva wants to come to its own, it must learn to shed its inhibitions and do this. So rape as an agenda of Hindutva has been around for a very long time. And we've seen it happen in Gujarat. And here it was in Muzaffarnagar in these slogans, in this open, naked way. Now, as a mirror image to what's happening in Muzaffarnagar, just so that we know, it's not only the Sangh Parivar that's doing this. Of course, it's one of the most vocal advocates of it. Now, you go to Tamil Nadu. Now, because in Western Uttar Pradesh, Muzaffarnagar, Haryana, you can imagine all this because you're able to say, all right, you know, less education, it's these backward khap panchayats, it's jat, jats and so on and so forth. But if you come to Tamil Nadu, this is supposed to be one of the most literate states, this is supposed to be one of the most emancipated states, and so on and so forth. What do you have there? You recently had, inter-caste marriages have been happening there. In fact, if you look at Tamil Nadu's history, you actually have a self-respect movement and Periyar advocating inter-caste marriages. You had people publicly performing inter-caste marriages. You had movements against the caste hierarchy, very openly so. And you had Periyar's very, very strong anti-patriarchal agenda where he would tell, he would write pamphlets telling women you shouldn't marry, you should use contraception, you shouldn't have children unless you want to, and be free of all this childbearing and motherhood and this and all this rubbish about chastity. You know, he rubbished chastity, he said, something about the Tamil word for chastity being mandangatti, it's bullshit, basically. He said it's rubbish. Now, in that Tamil Nadu, of course, subsequently, the Dravidian parties and all have already been moving in the direction of extreme conservatism when it comes to women, comes to gender. All the emancipatory potential of Periyar and all of that has, gone to the dogs largely. But in Dharmapuri, you had this time the Pattani Makkal Katchi, which is a Tamil party, which was aiming at consolidating its base among the Vanniyar caste, which is a backward caste in Tamil Nadu. And how did they do that? By portraying Dalit young men as being, the persons wearing jeans, the persons using mobile phones, and the persons targeting our daughters, our sisters. They are marrying our women. So intercaste marriages were openly targeted, less openly so in public speeches, although it was done even there, but if you confronted them on it in the media and so on, they would say, we're just worried because intercaste marriages never really work out and we're worried about the safety of our girls who marry in these marriages and later they're dumped and this and that. But if you looked at the social media and the Facebook pages and all of that, profiling of the youth in certain ways as lustful, as more, sexually lustful. So it's very similar to the ways in which the Sangh Parivar is profiling Muslim youth. And so it's very clear that even for any emancipatory movement, today we are poised in an India where there's this attempt to project Narendra Modi as a prime minister. There's all kinds of discussions and debates happening around that. And at that time, it's extremely important to remember that even for any emancipatory left progressive any agenda, it's become increasingly clear. It was always clear, but it should have been clear always. It's becoming increasingly clear now that you can't articulate that agenda without having a slogan of women's freedom from the custodial shackles of the household and freedom in so many other contexts at the heart of all of that. Now, I just want to one more point which I think we need to think about a little bit more, and in fact I think that is something which needs more analysis and a closer look at it. Now the thing is that it's very easy to understand what you mean by freedom in an Indian context, okay? Because you're able to say, the unfreedom is so obviously visible. You're not free to marry who you like, or you're not free to dress as you like, or whatever it is. It's very obvious, it's very clear, you can see it easily. And it's all too easy, I feel, to project it as though all this freedom for women and the need for emancipation and the slogan for freedom is something that happens out there. It happens in India, and it doesn't. It's something with which we can feel sympathy, we can feel a need to, you know, feel this sense of, sympathy for Indian women and say, oh, you know, poor things, are you, you know, is it really bad out on the streets there, are you safe, all of that. But to really understand, you know, it's as though the, it's as though an advanced capitalist country like the United States or like Britain or whatever it is, has actually now jettisoned the idea of emancipation, which obviously, as we know, is not the case. So I think it's important to look at how rape and rape culture are not something specific to Indian backwardness. Obviously, in India, they would have specifics which we in India are fighting those specifics, and we are doing it all the time. So we understand how caste plays in there. We are the ones challenging the idea of it's all being put down to westernization. So we are up to doing it there. But I think the real question is to ask then that what are we asking for when we say freedom? Are we asking for capitalist modernity alone? Are we saying that all we want to do is to have the freedom to become Miss America? Is that what it's all about? So I think that but it's important to remember that it's not, you know. Because for one thing, as I said earlier, rape culture is everywhere. You've had American senators talk about genuine rapes and, you know, not so genuine rapes. And about how you apparently can't get pregnant with genuine rapes, all right? So you've been told that by American senators here. So clearly, there's a constituency for rape culture right here. You've had the slut walk protests starting in Canada when a Canadian cop made the kind of remarks we hear in Delhi all the time. And I think that even beyond a patriarchal ideology or culture, there is something else that requires examination. I feel that we don't really know whether rapes have gone up or whether there's more violence or just more violence being reported, right? Whether in India or anywhere else. But we do know that this kind of public statements by persons in authority of various kinds making various shades of rape culture remarks, this has certainly, and I'm seeing a lot more of it. I don't know whether it's scientifically true to say there's more of it around, but it does seem to be more visible, more in your face and all of that. So what is that all about, if that is true? I would say that, you know, you're having, the one thing that we do have in common across the world is you're having these neoliberal policies that are making, that are putting a renewed burden on women, a burden that they have tried to shed in earlier decades of the women's movement. So things like, you know, the household labor, the burden of household labor. You know, in earlier decades of the women's movement, there's been a demand on the state to provide welfare, to provide certain kinds of support for single women, for women, all of that. And I think that those are now subject to cuts. You're having these austerity measures happening across the globe. And you are having then a renewed need to ask women to bear a greater burden inside the house, to bear a greater burden of household labor, to be available as client labor within the household, and also as client labor outside the household. Specifically, of course, for immigrant women, for women in countries like India, Bangladesh, South Asian countries, all of that. So you're having this as a need, and I would say that rape culture is at least one element in the ideological corpus of trying to boost up that entire global economy in that way. And I can see it happening in India all the time because, you know, it's important to remember that, of course, Indian patriarchy, you know, the caste structures in India are implicated in violence against women in India. But they're not the only ones who are implicated there. And I think it's important to remember that because, you know, what comes dressed up as empowerment and liberation for Indian women today is something which is really very, very, very double-edged. Because if you look at something, I'll just give you a few examples. One is if you look at the self-help groups, you know, the microfinance institutions, which were really, we were told that, you know, these are majorly emancipatory and all of that. What has happened there? If you look at their literature, they're actually talking about how women are more less likely to default on loans, and so we prefer to give women loans because they're less mobile, they're less likely to run away from the village to the city. or they are more susceptible to shame. It's easier to publicly shame them into repaying loans and so on. So actually, it is the vulnerability of those women which is being used. Or if you have something like the garment factories, and you saw, we know that America is the place where the Triangle Fire happened in, what was it, 1913. Now, in Bangladesh, the factory fires that have happened with garment workers in Bangladesh just now, a factory has collapsed in one case, there's been a factory fire in another case, and there's a huge number of deaths of workers, mostly women. All right. So when you think about the context in which those women are fighting their patriarchies, how does it help them to be insecure in this way in the workplace? It is their insecurity and their vulnerability that is actually making them attractive as labor for global capital, which is then implicated in that violence. So I think that what we need to do, and that requires probably much more analysis that can happen both from here, from the United States, from other centers of global capital, as well as from the periphery, from countries like India. So I see a lot of scope for that kind of solidarity and that kind of shared analysis. And I think it's really important to remember that it's not a question of unfree Indian women and free American women, but actually for a need for emancipation for women across the globe. And I'm hoping that in the question answers we'll get to talk about other aspects of this. But I'd just like to leave it with one thought which we can maybe take forward in the questions, which is, how would you define, I'd like to hear more from you about that as well. How would you think about the agenda of freedom or emancipation for women in America today? All right. Of course, there's the question of race and racial oppression, and the question of violence against women hasn't gone away. It's very much there even now. And in the discussions we've been having in India recently, there's been one school of thought that's tried to say that in India there is a structural reason for violence, but in somewhere like America, it's just ideological, it's not really structural. Capitalism doesn't need this kind of violence anymore. But I think that a lot of us have been seeking to challenge that, bringing up the questions which I just tried to flag briefly now, about how the neoliberal economy probably does require this kind of violence. And certainly, if violence is not something exceptional that happens in certain graphic ways, if it is actually deeply embedded in the ways in which women's household labor and unpaid labor in the household and their availability as labor outside the household is made to happen, then I think that we can't see it as anything but structural anywhere in the world. And we probably need to analyze what is happening with those structures. We have earlier analysis, but I think that an analysis of this specific juncture is probably something that is still waiting to happen, and I'm hoping that we can have more of that. Minutes to do that. That's just so that you get a better sense of what was happening on the ground in the movement, beyond the images which you probably seen in most of them. So I'll just briefly contextualize them as we discuss them. This one is actually one of the one of the images of the protest at Sheila Dixit's house, the same one that Raka talked about right in the beginning. So this is some of the some of the students who were there, and some of the students were mobilized from student organizations in the Jawaharlal Nehru University, but there were lots of students who spontaneously had joined this protest, hearing about it on social media and all of that from Delhi University, from lots of colleges. Can you move on to the next one? See, this is one on that day, all right? So you can read the, are you able to read this one? Yeah. So these were all Delhi University students who had the versions up there, okay. Can you move on? This is, of course, the mobilization at India Gate, and it was this huge, spontaneous thing that went on for hours, two whole days, actually, and in spite of repeated tear gassing and all of that. Yeah. Now, this one I wanted to show you because this is, this happened a lot. The slogans would be that, the noose and the death penalty demand and all that. This one and the next photograph. Move on, please. Yeah. This one also is about, ashamed to be Indian, it says, and then it says, Pasi to the rapist. There was lots of this protest happening. So you'll see in the subsequent photographs that there are these slogans side by side with other slogans as well. This one is somebody holding a slogan at the India Gate protest that says, The death penalty is not right. Hanging is no solution. And it's patriarchy that's the problem. And you should, this is an opportunity and we should get rid of it now. Uma. So this is, of course, Uma, please. Yeah. Then this one is again, even this is at India Gate. This is somebody saying, you're sitting in parliament, and this is a young girl holding a placard saying, you're sitting in parliament, break your bangles, and you leave the, what to do with the rapists, you leave it to us, you know, we'll take care of them, that kind of thing. So the thing is that, again, this whole business about even young women seeing no irony in, you know, basically saying, if you're wearing bangles, there's something wrong with you, all right, you know, there's something effeminate about you. But I think that, I just want to show you that this was also happening side by side with all the other students. Please move on. And this is in response actually to a statement made by Sushma Swaraj, who is a BJP leader. She was in parliament talking about the rape on December 18th. And she made this eloquent speech about rape, and she talked about how the survivor of rape is a Vrinda Lash. She's a living corpse. So basically life is over after rape. You're as good as dead if you're raped. So there were a lot of these slogans. This is one by the JNU Students Union. This one says that you know, those who survive rape are not you know, living corpses. Yeah. Then this is an ad which the Delhi police had put out before the December 16th case, but I just wanted to show it because this is Farhan Akhtar, who's a well-known actor. And you know, you can read the slogan, it speaks for itself. It says, make Delhi safer for women. Are you man enough to join? So, you know, it's all addressing the idea. There have been other similar posters, similar campaigns about being real men, how real men don't rape and stuff like that. So all these were also you know, brought into question and challenged quite a bit in the movement. Yeah. Then this one is the one I mentioned, which says, Nazar tumhari buri parda hum kyun kare? You know, if there's something wrong with the way you look at women, why should women have to be the ones who cover themselves up? Yeah. Next, please. Then this is at India Gate. And you can see that on the side, most of these are the protesters from Jawaharlal Nehru University, students who had organized this, the Students Union and other groups who had organized this. And so this was part of a large gathering at India Gate. You saw the, you know, the big picture there. So you have persons with the hand rapist slogan, but you also have other persons with other slogans, including that one right on the corner there, which is the picture of Soni Sori, an Adivasi woman who was has been subjected to custodial rape and torture, sexual torture in a prison in Chhattisgarh, which is the state incidentally where I come from. And what we would do is we would use those images of Soni Sori or of protests in Manipur to actually introduce, to tell people about her and about those issues, unresolved issues of rape and those pending struggles for justice. This one also is similar. You can see Soni there and people raising slogans about her. Yeah. Next, please. Yeah. Then this one is one of the images from the 26th January Freedom Parade that I talked about, where this has the name of Bilkis Banu, who was one of the women raped during the Gujarat communal violence of 2002. Next, please. Yeah. Then this one is a Jantar Mantar, where these are Kashmiri students who are holding slogans about saying thank you AFSPA and Armed Forces Special Powers Act and Public Security Act, and talking about the number of rapes from 1989 and the number of killings, custodial killings, structures destroyed, women widowed, children orphaned, women raped, illegal detentions. This one and the next one, please. Yeah. So this one is about the Kunan Poshpura rape, where 80 women were gang raped in one night by the army and where there's been no justice since then. The interesting thing about this is, you know, as I said, the slogan we were raising when we were, you know, flustered at India Gate as to how to counter that death penalty slogan, which was so overwhelmingly there, so how to dislodge it a little and make room for other slogans. So somehow in the thick of that, the slogan came, Hum kya chahte Azadi, and the cadence was the same cadence that the Kashmiris raised for Kashmiri Azadi. Okay, so they were a little uneasy to begin with, saying that's our Azadi slogan, are you going to talk about us at all or not, you know, that kind of thing. So, of course, we would take the opportunity with these slogans to actually, you know, tell people to go and talk to these students and understand about sexual violence and other kinds of violence in Kashmir and how that's enabled by the Indian state. Next, please. Yeah. This is the 26th January parade, and it was, see, 24th January, the Justice Varma Committee had submitted its report, and it's quite a good and landmark report. So it said implement Justice Verma Committee recommendations now. And you can see in the front row there's that slogan with Your Republic Rapes in Kashmir. Use the slogan Azadi, don't forget Kashmir. That's also there right up in front. Next, please. Yeah. Then this one is something somebody's written that says Bhagwat is the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh chief, which I talked about, who talked about India and Bharat, about how rapes happen only to westernized women. So it says Bhagwat ka bhand nahi, Maulana ka farman nahi, no, you know, none of the fatwas by the, you know, the religious heads. Neta ka bhashan nahi, we don't want politician speeches. Force police ka jul nahi, so no to state repression by the police or the army. Bekhauf azadi abhi chahiye. So this this was the main banner also, that women want freedom without fear, Bekhauf azadi. So this was one of the slogans that somebody had made. Next, please. Yeah. Then this is the Your Republic Rapes in Kashmir slogan. Yeah. Next, please. Yeah. Then these are some of the other slogans raised from that. You see, they have posters with unknown citizen on it. Because by that time, they knew that the name of the girl who had been raped on December 16th was, by that time, it had filtered out in the media here and there, and her parents were saying, we want people to know. All right. So, since we knew that her name would probably be taken in some of the slogans, we didn't want hers to be the only name there, you know, standing out as an exception. So that's why we made this long list of names of places and persons associated with sexual violence in different contexts. And then we also had unknown citizen in lots of places. And then this is one of the slogans that says, and remember this is 26 January when the military parade has just happened. So it says, Jan ke hathyar nahi, inqilab ke aujaar chahiye. We don't want the weapons of war, we want the implements of the revolution. Next, please. Yeah. So this is this one. The girl has a hand, something in her hand that says Rajpat tumara hoga, Janpat hamara hai. So it's something like Wall Street and Main Street. So Rajpat is where the military parade happened, and where actually people had protested and had been tear gassed and chased off. So they said, okay, you keep Rajpat, we'll keep Janpat. You know, people's path. Yeah. So next one. And then this is at the end, oh, I forgot to tell you that this is at the end of the 26th January parade. What we did was we had these pictures of all these persons who had recently made rape culture remarks. Okay, so Bhutsa Satyanarayana, Nasaram Bapu, and Mohan Bhagwat, and all of that. And we had these Mardan ki Maryada medals that the young girls gave them. Okay, so this is that's what's happening here. They're giving them these Mardan ki, you know, this masculinity. Mardan ki is masculinity, and Maryada is, you know, a word with so many connotations, because it's basically about honor and so on and so forth. So, yeah, next, please. Yeah. Then this is just something to show you. This is actually one of the posters with some of Gaurav Pandey's poetry on it. And this was on the day of New Year. So we did, you know, we did this protest at Jantar-Mantar and at Central Park, where we dedicated the New Year to women's freedom and everyone's freedom. Next, please. Yeah. This is, see, on the day when the December 16th rape victim died, that was actually a day again at Jantar-Mantar in the morning when people had gathered, the early morning she died, and when people gathered at Jantar-Mantar, initially there was one small group, and that was quite a political group actually, because it was, it had Sangh Parivar elements in it as well, who were raising slogans of death penalty and nothing else. So we tried to say, let's be silent today, but they didn't agree. So then we found that some youngsters had just come and were sitting apart, just silently sitting and shedding tears. So what we did was we just went and sat with them and made it possible for everyone coming to choose whether they would like to just sit there quietly. So for hours actually in the morning, from around 9 in the morning till about noon, people just sat there without any sound. And then it became a huge gathering of people sitting there silently and a tiny knot of people shouting slogans somewhere else. And then gradually what happened was that then we thought, just to keep things going, keep the momentum going, there were songs for quite a while. Some of the cultural groups would contribute songs and all of that. And towards the evening, what they decided, what the group, the crowd decided there was that we just want young women to speak, no one else. So you had young students, school students, college students speaking, no one else. None of the, you know, even none of us spoke there, none of the women's movement leaders spoke either. So that, and at the end of it, there was this candle march. So of course, even in the candle march, there were other places where people were using the death penalty slogan, and but a very, very large number who were not. So, yeah. Next, please. Yeah. Yeah, this is just one of the slogans that says, end the culture of justifying rape by accusing women of provocation. Defend women's right to freedom without fear. Yeah. Next, please. Yeah. This is actually on February 21st, which is the first day that Parliament session was held. We wanted that the government should implement the Justice Verma recommendations in the new law, and the most important issues out here, you know, there were several of them, but also about custodial rape and marital rape and all of that. And so this was this People's Watch over Parliament that we said we are watching and we want to. And so that was also quite a good gathering, and it happened for the whole day, and people were saying that we want you to pass a law that is not the government. The government had come up with an ordinance which was quite a travesty of what the Justice Verma report stood for. So we were asking for a better bill. Next, please. Yeah. And in that February 21st program, you can say that it says scrap section 377, which is the law that criminalizes homosexuality. And, you know, and then this also says, this is again, you know, that another variant of the Bake Off Azadi slogan that says, Jamhooriyat ka ek hi naam, Bake Off Aurat Azad Insaan. So it talks about the free woman and the free person, the free human being. Yes. Next, please. This is just a slogan from Pasha's poetry, you know, for those who know. Just to say that there's a lot of poetry and a lot of things that people brought to it beyond the images that you usually get to see. Next, please. Yeah. That poetry, that poem of Pasha actually talks about how it's time to come out onto the streets and out of your homes to protest. Yeah. This is actually, but I just want to show you that it wasn't happening only in Delhi. This happened everywhere. You know, I heard about protests happening in villages in Punjab, in villages in Bihar, in when I visited Jammu, where my organization doesn't really have a unit, but somebody had called me there, so we had gone there. And I was told that a huge, around 2,000 girls in Jammu had held a protest spontaneously. There was no group that had organized it. There had been a protest. And this is a protest in Varanasi. Of course, this was organized by the students group and women's group and some youth groups. But the participation went beyond the membership of those groups. And you can see that there's a large number of women on the streets of Banaras, and you know, it says Kashi Vidyapeeth and Kashi Vishwanath Mandir and all in the background. So this was another one of those images. I think that's it. Is that the last one? Yes.
For really for this extraordinary talk, Kavita, and for making us think about not just you know, sexual violence in the way that we often think about it, but of really thinking about sort of the national investment in patriarchy at multiple levels, and to make us think about the challenge that we have before us to change the discourse around sexual violence. I mean, this is something that really struck me in your words, to change the discourse around sexual violence so that it actually doesn't fall into the hands of the sort of, you know, we always told you so, if you behave a certain way, you know, you will be safe. So to change the discourse around sexual violence so that it precisely unsettles these sort of comfortable patriarchal shibboleths about women's safety. So I really want to thank you for that. And since I don't want to be talking most of the time, I'm going to ask you just two questions, and then I'll open it up for conversation. So let me actually start with something that you hinted at when you talked about the fact that marital rape wasn't really counted did not count as rape. One of our former students, Vasundhara Srinathi, wrote this very interesting article where she actually said that in the year 2012, just out of counting rapes that were reported, right, there were 24,923 reported rapes in India. But out of these 24,923 reported rapes, 24,470 were committed by parents, friends, or family. That leaves 453 that were actually stranger rape, right? But when people are raising these slogans for death penalty, et cetera, they're actually not imagining that they're going to hang their cousin, right? They're actually imagining that they're going to hang some stranger. And I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about the avoidance of conversation about the vast number of rapes. And this is, of course, not even including marital rape.
Yeah, this was one of the things that we would, in fact, include as part of the posters and slogans and all in the movement, precisely to point out, of course, in the argument against the death penalty, but also to say that, look, you know, the inhibition to report a rape is often because it involves reporting a rape against someone who's known, who's trusted, who's respected, Even if the woman's word is believed by her near and dear ones, it's terribly inhibiting, you would be discouraged from doing it. It's not only about the stigma that is attached to rape, it's also an inhibition with, you know, how much do you want that person punished and so on. So there's a lot of pressure not to report rape. The point is that, you know, in the women's movement groups, you're always working in conditions where you're trying to overcome this inhibition, all right? And how much harder that would become, you know, if you had a death penalty for rape was something which was very apparent to us, and we talked about that. But I think that beyond that, really it was, obviously it would make all of us extremely uneasy to talk about the rapes that were happening by trusted persons, okay. So the temptation to say, you know, subsequently to this Delhi, this big, the December 16th rape, there was a rape of a small child in Delhi by a neighbor, all right, and somebody whom, you know, she used to go and play with and so on, so it happened. Now, in that case, again, there was this whole discussion about is it happening because of pornography. So everybody's trying to point the finger away from where the real problem lay, which of course lay partly in the question that even the child in the family is someone who is encouraged, especially in a South Asian or Indian situation, not to ask questions, not to recognize the boundaries of their body and to recognize their own bodily integrity. You're encouraged to be very obedient, and you know, if you're a good girl, if you're a good boy, you don't ask questions, you will not question. And how that is actually makes you vulnerable to sexual exploitation. But beyond that, also the question of this happened in a working class neighborhood. And I think we'll talk a bit more about that after this. But it also raised the question of where are working class children supposed to remain, supposed to be safe when their parents are working? You know, so the whole question about where is the safety in a slum locality or in a working class locality? Where is that safe space for children supposed to be? You know, why can't we talk about that rather than talking about, you know, how alcohol or pornography or something is the problem leading men to rape? Okay.
So yes, you brought up class, and that is my next question. That is, in the two most prominent cases that have received the most attention, you have the young woman in Delhi, and then you have the photojournalist in Bombay, and both of these young women were seen as part of the aspirational middle class, where the guys who the men who were accused of raping them were seen as sort of, in Marxist terms, the lumpen proletariat, or you know, but just, you know, the unemployed, you know, the unemployed, the useless, the rejected. So they were the drag on India. They are the past of India. They're dragging new India down. It's really been played out in that way. And can you say a little bit, not just about, not just for your take on this, but about how the movement is trying to move the language away from there?
As I said, for one thing, there was a very conscious attempt, and there has been for a long time, not just after this case, but there's been a very conscious attempt to focus it there. Of course, in terms of class, but also even in terms of, for instance, in Mumbai, we all know that there's this parochial politics which has been developing there over the question of the identity of the Mumbaikar and the identity of the Maharashtrian citizen, and how the outsider coming from, you know, as a migrant laborer from Bihar and so on, they are the source of all crime, and now they're also the source of sexual crime, all right. And in Delhi also, there's been an attempt even by the Delhi chief minister to do precisely the same thing. So clearly, you know, that kind of discourse isn't only limited to the Shiv Sena and all of that. It's also something which P. Chidambaram used when he was home minister. It was used by Sheila Dikshit as chief minister. So even Congress governments did it no less. All right. So what we would have to do, and we realized that even in the movement, this was probably one area where we would talk about it. A lot of middle class girls also tend to look at, you know, it's the auto driver who's the problem. So, you know, there's been a regulation that now says that auto drivers can't say no, you know, they have to agree to always take a person to the destination that she wants to go. You can't say no to a woman and so on. So we've tried to change and challenge a bit of that. There are so many reasons why an auto driver might not want to, you know, go. Maybe he's headed home. Maybe he'd like to look for a sawari who is in the direction of home, if he's headed home for lunch or dinner or something like that. So, you know, you can't look at safety only in terms of putting the onus on the working class and demonizing them, but also to bring attention to the fact. So there was it was interesting because in the Jantar Mantar protest, there were a lot of domestic women workers who were participating regularly. All right. So they would actually take time off from work and come and make time, and so they would have to, you know, but they were regular faces there. So some of them would come and talk about, you know, how they would face sexual violence in those very middle class homes. So clearly, you know, they were migrant women workers. And then this whole idea, see, what we brought up often in discussion was that, you know, the idea is that the migrant male is somebody deprived of sex and therefore raping. You know, and if, you know, if rape is then about desire and unfulfilled desire of the working class, which is rapacious in its sexual appetite, then what about migrant women? All right, they are not even though the migrant women left back in the village are not raping. All right, migrant women coming to Delhi are not raping. So we try to, you know, bring in the whole question about, you know, migrant communities and the insecurities in which they live, and how you have to, you know, go to understanding how migrant women then are sexually vulnerable in very specific ways in precisely those middle class households which will tell themselves that it is the migrants who are the sexual aggressor. So a lot of these conversations happened. They were again conversations that caused uneasiness, and but it was helped by the fact that we did have participants in the movement who, you know, who had a sustained engagement with the movement, but who were themselves migrants, who were in, even in the 26th January march, there were women who were from slum localities in Delhi who joined the protest, who made time to come. There were women from these localities who would talk, come and say for the first time that they were being stalked and that they wanted to file a complaint. In at least one case, the stalker was someone who was very much from a more privileged background. So these were things that they would talk about, and they would, you know, get the courage and ask for support to go file a complaint and all of this. So all this was happening during the movement.
Let me ask one more question. Before I turn it over to all of you, I was thinking about the enormous excitement around the Anna Hazare movement when it first started. As various segments of the middle class really felt like this was finally, you know, the movement against corruption. It was, you know, a grassroots movement, etc., etc. And what you have now, all you have left of it, in essence, is sort of the Aam Aadmi Party. Right? All of that, the movement has sort of disappeared, and you have you have the Aam Aadmi Party as what is left. And I'm not going to compare this movement to Anna Hazare's movement, but what I am asking is, what do you think will be, you know, what are elements that you think will be sustained? Because you can't imagine that with the next rape there'll be as many protests, right? You can't. So what do you think will be sustained? What do you think has already been sustained, and what is your hope about what will be sustained?
I'll also briefly, you said you're not comparing, but I'll just briefly say that there were things which there were in common between both movements, in the sense of a participation of a lot of young persons from Delhi, sort of spontaneous participation in Delhi. But I think the big difference is that I think that movement, again, even in the anti-corruption movement, there was not just one strand, okay? There was maybe one Anna Hazare brand, you can say the Lokpal Bill and all of that, but I think beyond that, there were also other participants who were raising the whole question of corporate plunder being the source of violence, being the source of corruption, big ticket corruption and all of that. All that was happening as well. But I think that, one thing about the Anna Hazare strand of it, the more dominant strand of it there, was that it was premised on certain kinds of certainties, certain unambiguities, and the attempt to shut out ambiguities to avoid articulating specific debates over the economic policies and so on and so forth, largely. Whereas I think that in this moment, what was really exciting was that such a large part of it was interested precisely in the lack of certainties, in opening up questions that were shifting ground, that were pulling out the carpet from under our own feet. All of that was happening in this movement, and that was what was more exciting, I would say. Now, what we are taking away, I would say that ever since then, most of us who have participated there are flooded by weekly requests from schools, colleges, and not organized by teachers. Students themselves wanting to organize things and wanting to organize meetings, big meetings, small meetings, precisely to look into the, look more closely at all the issues that were raised in this movement. And I'm very confident that that will not stop happening after this verdict. Although, you know, there has been an attempt after the death penalty verdict to say, all right, closure, it's done, and dusted, like as I said. So I am confident that, and I think that is the biggest takeaway from it. The fact that it has opened up the spaces to talk about both things, and it looks as though there are still persons interested in doing that. Just very briefly, because you brought in the Aam Aadmi Party, I also want to briefly comment that, look, the Aam Aadmi Party was also a participant during this movement, but again, they were usually the forces which were raising these slogans about the Chudiya Pehlo and all of that, not only in this December 16th one, but even in the rape of the small child after that. In that case, her father was somehow close to the Aam Aadmi Party, so they had initiated the protests, and they were very remarkable protests. I don't deny that at all. But the way in which it was articulated was in a way which was designed to not allow these questions to impede in any way. And subsequently also, even now with the Delhi elections coming, you're seeing the Aam Aadmi Party saying, no rapes happen in Sheila Dixit's Delhi, they won't happen in Arvind Kejriwal's Delhi. We'll have youth brigades who will protect women on the streets. Now that's really scary, frankly, because you know, what are those youth brigades going to be doing exactly? What will they think about women? Will they do moral policing? What will they do? And then, of course, you also have, I'm very uneasy also with the fact that in the Aam Aadmi Party, you have a set of articulations that is, you know, quite progressive on some questions, like if you look at what Prashant Bhushan has to say and so on. But you also have someone like Kumar Vishwas. If you look at, he's a popular performer, and if you look at his, you know, his poetry sessions and all, much of the humor, and I'm not saying that's only Kumar Vishwas, it happens in other, in most humor, public humor in India certainly is premised on sexism, and in a very big dose of sexism. There's a lot of that there. And there's also the fact that I was very disturbed by the fact that after the Ishrat Jahan fake encounter, which for us in the women's movement is something which was a big issue which we've been raising throughout, while the Aam Aadmi Party took a position saying, yes, fake encounter, you had Kumar Vishwas on social media and all of that going for repeatedly attacking the fact and saying that why do we need to bother about Ishrat Jahan when there are thousands dying in Uttarakhand, or when there are children dying of midday meal poisoning in Bihar, okay? So why do you need to worry about one Ishrat Jahan? So basically trying to suggest that she was a terrorist, and what, you know, Muslim girl died as a, you know, branded as terrorist, what does it matter? Encounter was fake or real, who cares? That kind of thing. So I'm saying that I'm very uneasy with those issues about gender, about communal violence, and about the intersect of all of that, about this whole discourse about Bharat Mata and nationalism. And I see that as very different. Look at the Aam Aadmi Party signaling with the Indian flag and all of that. And in this movement, the 26th January thing could happen. So I'm just saying with a similar audience, with a similar participants base, I won't say audience, but similar participant base, okay, similar persons participating, it was very possible to actually shift the discourse this time in this movement in a very different direction, which I don't think the Aam Aadmi Party was very interested in doing, and neither was Anand.
Okay, thank you. Let me open it up, and when I recognize you, please will you go to a mic? Okay. Bob, there was three, Ruma, here, and here. That's five. Okay. Please go to mics. Go ahead, Bob.
Thank you very much, Kavita, for this very wide-ranging, fascinating talk. You spoke very eloquently about kind of cultural inflections of the patriarchy in India and the West and so on, in terms of public and domestic spaces having to do with marriage, freedom, et cetera, et cetera. But one thing I didn't hear you mention, which is very much on my mind because I'm involved in some cases involving this, is the question of women's reproductive rights. And that is, as you know, in this country, the pushback by the patriarchy is very much in the direction of denying women of abortion rights and contraceptive rights. Now, in the South Asian community, at least here, that I've been somewhat involved with, the push is actually toward coerced abortions for sex selective purposes. So I don't know, I don't hear that being brought up in this context. So I wonder if you could say one or two words about that.
Yeah. Thank you. Kavita has asked that I take a few questions, so we'll take a couple of them.
As you wish to do. As
it's better. Yeah, well, I'll just take three of them. Okay. How about that? Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming here today and sharing your Elizabeth experiences. Very enlightening. My question is, you mentioned this common motif about familial culture and how a lot of the things that occur inside the household are very touchy-feely subjects people don't want to talk about. Especially if you want to change laws in sources that come from this whole thing of like custodial rape. So my question is the reason why it's so difficult to speak about these issues that are clearly inherited from a family culture because people believe it comes from a Western notion and they don't want the Western images to come in and talk about things? So just curious about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Namita, for your excellent talk and for your work that you do in India. I have two questions. First one is about, you mentioned Justice Verma report. You mentioned the Justice Verma report, and he was actually responsible for keeping the AFPA, Armed Forces Special Powers Act, intact when he was the acting Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. And secondly, in his otherwise pretty progressive report of 674 pages, he mentions Kashmir twice. Kashmiris, zero. This despite the fact that Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, in their 2006 report clearly indicate that of all the conflict zones in the world, Kashmir has the highest rate of sexual violence. Just to give you an idea, the rate of, I think, rape per 100,000 in Haryana is 1.7. In Kashmir, for women only, it's supposed to be 2.52. If you include the men, it's 25 per 100,000. The men are raped 10 times as often as women by the forced Indian state as a weapon of war, right? So there is patriarchy and there's use of rape as a weapon of occupation. And even in your slogan, Hum kya chahte azadi, bhai se bhi azadi. So I mean that, you know, baap se bhi azadi, which is pretty usual for a critique of patriarchy and, you know, a patriarchal tradition and protectionist tradition. However, in Kashmir, we want azadi with our men, with our brothers who are raped, you know, fake encounter and massacred and tortured. Right? So that's my first question. How do you keep that framework, which is extremely crucial? The second one has to do with the critique from the Dalit feminist intellectuals. And I'm thinking of the Savari group or the Roundtable group, where there was a spate of articles that was published, and their critique even of keeping the caste status, the caste rotation of Jyoti Pandey was precisely that it's as if for the group here, a black woman is raped in West Auckland and her race is kept silent. It could be as preposterous as that. And of course, while she was alive, there was, you know, reason to keep, there's legal reason to keep her name out of the picture. But as Flavia Agnes just wrote a marvelous article saying, here's a woman that Indians want to memorialize, valorize. Yet, if she was called by this name, she wouldn't respond to that. It's going against the very specific request of her father to be memorialized with her name. if you could respond.
Okay, I'm going to stop there because there were actually four or five questions already, so let me turn to you, and then as she speaks, go ahead.
One of the question you asked about sex selective abortion. See, I think that, you know, I've had conversations even recently about that, even with women who are working on the issue in America. And they told me about a film that's been made, anti-abortion film here, that uses the question of sex-selective abortion in India to build a case against abortion here. So, you know, clearly the women's movement in India has also had to reflect upon their use of terms like female feticide and so on, which used to be used quite unreflectively earlier, to say that, no, we don't want to use the word feticide or the killing of the fetus, we would like rather say sex-selective abortion. Now, I think that you know, the question there is how do we raise that issue in a way that respects that frames it in terms of reproductive rights, all right? And I think that is a very complex question because and what we have there's quite a bit of debate on it in India, and I don't want to take too much time to summarize it here. But just very briefly, I would say, and I just express what I feel about it, which is that I think that, you know, there has to be a way in which we frame the problem of sex-selective abortion as being about how we increase the possibility for agency for women in their own lives. Because just a ban on sex selective abortion, see, I'm for retaining the ban on doctors telling women in India about, telling families in India about the sex of the fetus, all right? Because that is something which is then used commercially to promote sex selective abortion, and I think that that needs to be implemented. It's hardly implemented now, but it needs to be. But I also think that in terms of criminalizing the woman who has committed the abortion or who has committed a female infanticide, I can share with you just one instance where I was briefly in jail in 2007 in the course of some movement, and there was a woman inside the jail who had been who was very sick, and she told me that she had been jailed for killing her newborn baby girl, right, in a hospital in Delhi.